the insanely dangerous retro pod show is proud to be part of the Scene Stealers podcast network and their international convention agency, who have a top draw roster of bodacious 80s and 90s stars who are ready to attend your next Comic Con or any other kick-ass event. Do not be dangerously insane. Check them out now and you will not regret it. Bosh. Right, pod fans, on with the show.
Stand by. You're live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello yet again and welcome to the Insanely Dangerous Retro Pod Show. We are the world's most fearsome fighting team. We feel the magic and hear the roar as we celebrate, venerate and ejaculate the very best of times, aka the 1980s and the 1990s. It's a real wacky show where anything goes. Each week, we leap back and forward in time, striving to put right what once went wrong, and hoping that the next leap will be the leap home. Joining me on this 50p shop calamity clusterfuck, where Paul Young lays his hat, is a stoic 1980s encyclopedia that just happens to be the inspiration for Roxette's third best song. He is the bastard love child of Arne Anderson and the ginger bloke from Mask. He's amazing. He's fantastic. Wherever there is trouble, he'll be there. Welcome to tonight's show, Dangerous Dave.
Good evening, Gaz. Yes, we're back again. How are you doing?
Yes, not too shabby. I am, well, apart from the COVID cough that's still lingering, more like the COVID mucus in the lungs that just won't quit, and everything else is hunky-dory. Back to the old, you know, the normal. I would say that the brain fog was gone, but I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know if that's just me though. I don't know if I've got if I'm still suffering from COVID brain fog or whether I'm just thick as pig shit. I'm not. I'm not too sure, but maybe we'll see. Maybe we'll find out on the show tonight. You never know.
Absolutely. So, how's Ellie doing with it? You were saying she had it last week.
She ended up having it a bit longer than I did. I got over mine relatively quickly and I wasn't contagious nearly as long as she was. But she's now gone back to work. They said, look, we don't care as long as you're not dying. Come back in and wear a mask. Such is the way in the UK.
Yes.
Now everything is just like, well, yes, we've had 2 years of it. Now just crack the fuck on.
Now everyone else is catching COVID.
Right.
Because obviously all the restrictions are gone and everyone's just like, yep, here we go. You're getting COVID and you're getting COVID. Everybody's getting COVID now.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter now because there's a war.
Yes, that's true. The COVID is gone.
That's yesterday's news, baby. Wait, you with your PPE. Go on, piss off. Go back to flogging cheap shoes. Go on, we don't want you anymore. Yes. We're sick of you. But yeah, that's it. This is the world. This is the world now. It's all right. It could be worse.
Yeah, I suppose so. So well, I guess we should maybe just crack on from the disappointing news worldwide and just crack on and ask the age-old question of what are we going to talk about this week, Gaz?
Well, this week, we're talking about the wildly popular cult Australian soap opera Neighbours. First aired on the Seven Network on the 18th of March 1985, It was created by television executive Reg Watson and ran for 37 years. The series centres on the residents of Ramsey Street, a cul-de-sac in the fictional suburb of Erinsborough. Conceived and written so that it was down-to-earth, character-driven storylines would appeal to both Australian and British audiences, Neighbours found itself wildly popular with younger viewers in the UK throughout the 80s and 90s. A whole host of talent has appeared on the show over the years, from heartthrobs, pop stars, A-listers, well-loved character actors and cult mainstays. It has influenced children's names, language and popular culture, and although it has not enjoyed the same success in recent years, its heyday star will continue to shine long after its impending cancellation. Now, we are all too aware, okay, that Neighbours is actually spent more time out of the 80s and 90s than it ever did in the 80s and 90s. So it's like, technically, is it 80s and 90s? However, Dangerous knows where I live, and he said he was going to send the boys around if we didn't cover this to break my knees. And I laughed at him and said, my knees are fucked anyway. They'll probably just improve them. So good luck. And then he threatened me with watching High School Musical on repeat. So I
something I caved, which I wouldn't actually watch myself. Yeah.
But I caved instantly. I folded like a cheap suit. I just went, no, please. So yes, here we go. But as so that we're keeping it retro like Electro, my abusive chum. I think we should be looking back towards our chosen era. And we should be cherry picking our favorite or even just the most shocking or memorable scenes and characters.
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, yes. Well, I mean, Neighbours was a massive stay in the 80s and 90s for us kids at school. So we'd all come home and watch the children's BBC and we'd be there waiting for the 5:35 episode of Neighbours. Well, I would be anyway, so I don't know about everybody else.
I think everyone did. Yeah. I actually, for a long time, I didn't go home straight away. I'd go around somebody else's house. I wouldn't always get to watch all of Neighbours because that's when my mum would come and pick me up.
Right.
But after a certain point, I did then go home and I did end up watching Neighbours. But then I don't know. I as much as I think, oh, I've got my childhood nailed. I know this. I know that happened. I must have just not watched it for years. I can't remember because it's like, well, hang on a second. I used to play football from like after when school finished and then until it got dark.
Right.
So when did I watch Neighbours at home by myself? When did I do this? I don't know. Like, it's not like there's repeats either, is there?
Well, I think it was on twice a day, one at lunchtime, which is when you found out when you were ill that you were like, hang on a minute, Neighbours is on. Neighbours is on just before going for gold, is it? Wow, okay. But yeah, I mean, I think they repeated it on like UK TV Gold or something.
Well, there you go. That's probably where I've ended up watching it all, and I know so much about it then.
Yeah.
The later years, anyway. Well, later years for me. Okay, let's kick this off then. Okay, grab a pillow, everyone, because we're going to go in hard and dry straight away.
All right. What are you going to say? We're putting you to sleep already.
No, we're going for the big one straight away. The Scott and Charlene wedding. Bam! Oh. Too much, too deep, too deep, even. too soon, I hear you cry. Well, yes, that's how we like it on this show. I can imagine everyone's like, oh, they'll leave that till last, and it'll be the crowning moment. But no, we do things differently around these parts. We start off well and then tail off. End badly. Yes. So, yeah, we'll start off with the old Scott and Charlene wedding.
Yes.
See, that seems to be the thing that everyone remembers. And, like, we touched on it a little bit a couple of weeks ago on what happened way back when we were talking about, especially for you,
Yes, indeed.
I think we said, you know, where did this come from? It was obviously it came from Neighbours, you know, because Jason Donovan and Kylie Minogue, obviously, you know, very big in the UK charts for a wee while in the 80s and 90s, but obviously met and via Neighbours.
Yeah.
And they were the couple. Like, this was covered by newspapers. Like, this wasn't just any old soap opera, was it? This was, you know, I'm sure there's other, we've all watched soap operas and we've all enjoyed it and everything, but this was a different time, and this was a foreign soap opera. Now, I'm not saying all foreign soap operas were farted on, but we already had, like, EastEnders, Coronation Street, Emmerdale, blah, blah, blah.
Farm, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Emmerdale Farm, yeah. As it was known back in the day. But, yeah, so what I say, a lot of younger people like us, you know, we kind of, like, lapped up the foreign stuff. We were like, oh, wow, cool. It's not rainy and wet and cold like into this kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah, look, what flashy stuff are they doing abroad? Whereas a lot of older people are maybe a bit like, no. It's full of people. None of them are called Doris or Norman. And none of them work down a mine or in a butcher's. Like, there's not even a pub. So, which seems to be like, if you're going to be doing a UK sitcom, soap opera, sorry, it needs to be a pub in there, apparently. It was very much a youth-driven program, but yeah, it was all over the newspapers. Yeah, oh, we can't believe it. We're so looking forward to the big wedding. It was on TV. Not, and I don't just mean the episode. I mean, like, you know, the news covered this.
Yeah.
I mean, that seems a bit bonkers, doesn't it? Like, is there anything? Like, I can't imagine anyone. I can't imagine the BBC covering an EastEnders wedding.
No.
Wow, like, this is insane. Like, how, like, it turned up and it just blew us all away. It was like a cultural phenomenon. Like, why was this so important to us? Why was this wedding between these two young people we barely knew such a cultural importance in this country?
Wow. I mean, that's a tough one for me to answer, to be honest. I mean, I think the 80s were such a massive time for, you know, there was no internet, there was no, you know, you couldn't, like, find out what they were doing on Instagram or Twitter or whatever. You just had, like, the show and newspaper or magazine articles. Magazines were massive back in the 80s and 90s, and, you know, kids magazines, teen magazines would always have a story on the new sensations that were coming out. And I just remember being, obviously, having two sisters, like, you know, they would get their magazines. I just remember seeing them reading these magazines with the, you know, Kylie and Jason on the cover of them. So I just think it was just a fascination with a different culture in terms of them being Australian compared to us English. I just think it just went from there, really. Neighbours' popularity in the 80s was just, yeah, because it came out of nowhere, really. Because 85, I think I watched the first episode today, and I mean, I don't remember the first series. I remember it slightly, but I don't remember it that well. But I do remember it more when, like, Jason and Kylie and all these guys were in the show. Guy Pearce was in it as well, and I just remember it, like, I think it was the attraction to, like, they had, like, the older people in the cast as well, like Madge and Jim Robinson, Helen Daniels, but they obviously had a nice sprinkling of young teenage characters as well. So, I mean, you know, just the same in the 80s and the 90s, music stars, like, any kind of good looking star is going to get a lot of attention. So I think that's where that came from. But it was very, very strange. in a way, to think, you know, why were these two characters loved so much more than anyone else? And why was it being, you know, the UK lapped up Neighbours? Because obviously, like you said, you know, the BBC aren't going to cover a wedding of a of an EastEnders episode for two characters. And why they did it for Neighbours is, you know, only they would know that, I guess. But it just became something that just kind of exploded over here in the UK, I think.
Yeah, you made a really good point about the magazines, and you know, that was the Instagram and the Facebook of its day. You know, where this is when people could still read. young people knew how to read whole words.
Defo.
Yeah. PMSL. Yeah. You're absolutely right. Yeah, so they're good looking, and anytime anyone's good looking, it doesn't matter if you've got the world's greatest actors, if then stood next to them, you've got a decent looking young person who can with passable acting skills, they're going to be the star of the show. It's like sex sells kind of thing. And how do we get the young people with all their disposable time and income to spend money on this person? Oh, I know. Yes. Let's give them a singing career. nowadays, it's a bloody clothing brand or whatever, or, you know, perfume and et cetera, et cetera. But yeah. I think back in the day, yeah, it was there was no, you know, they couldn't market these young stars as much as they can today. They can't. You know, wring every single little ounce of appeal out of them before they dump them. Yeah. But yeah, you're absolutely right. Of course, it was. As well as that, I think the media had realised that young people were all over this, and the fact that it was aimed. They did end up going a bit sensational in the end. I think all soaps end up going completely balmy, like, you know, someone does brain surgery on themselves or something. I don't know. But they tried not to do that in the beginning, and it was, you know, slightly aimed towards us as well. And so you add all that together. I hadn't really thought of it until you said that. I thought obviously of the sex sales angle, but. Yeah, so, I mean, there's no internet. There's no internet. There's magazines. Sorry, I just got really, really distracted then by something flying past the window, and I completely freaked out. Sorry about that, listeners. I won't do that again. it's dark here, and I pooed my pants a little bit. Oh, anyway,
just a demon flying past.
We've got bats around here, right. But I always forget that we've got bats around here, and it just a little part of me just started crying inside. a cracking point. Now that's amazing. Yeah, so if you think about it, if you're going back, it's not a cultural thing that was just back then or nowadays. This is something that there's always been around. It's just got a different front on it now. It's got a different mask, yeah. I guess. But yeah, oh wow, and that's strange as well. Because all right, Jason Donovan's more of a cult performing artist amongst a certain age group, a certain demographic,
right.
I would say, is that he's not like one, you know, he's not got like several number ones under his belt. And yeah, he was on posters on people's walls over like two decades, like Kylie.
Yeah.
But he is loved by a certain demographic in this country.
He is.
So much so that apparently like his daughter ended up in Neighbours as well. Did you see this?
I believe so, yeah. I think I vaguely remember the story, yeah.
I think that's pretty bloody cool.
Yeah. And I think his dad was in Neighbours as well, so... his dad played a character quite some time, actually. I think it was after, obviously, Jason had gone. But Terrence Donovan was, oh, God, I'm trying to remember his name now. It's, you know, it was Doug Willis.
No, Doug?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Wow.
Pam and Doug. Yes. Played by Terrence Donovan.
Oh, Dougie! Oh, I love that. It's so weird that throughout all the research and everything I did today, I completely forgot, and I didn't see any mention of Doug whatsoever. No, I don't know why. That's
okay.
That's bonkers. Because yeah, I remember being such a big part of it, and that's Jason Donovan's dad.
It was. It is.
Wow. That's so cool. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if I can see the family resemblance there or not, but wow. I'm sorry, I'm just so thrilled. That's made my day to know that Doug is Jason Donovan's dad. I'm so happy. Wow, there you go. But yeah, so I can't believe there wasn't more made of that. I feel like that's something that all of my friends and other people that I didn't really like that I knew that watched Neighbours would have loved to have known.
Right.
That's sad that we didn't all know about that. Oh, I have to find another, like, let's find another Neighbours fan. Well, you know, like a prop, yeah, I say another one. I'm not actually a Neighbours fan, but
okay.
I'm going to have to go and find one so that I can go and impress them with my knowledge now.
Yeah, unless they may already know. You never know.
I hope not.
It is pretty well known that Terrence Donovan played Doug Willis and, you know, he's Jace's dad. So I would imagine, the casual fan may not know, but the diehards would probably know the link.
Oh, what world has been rocked?
Oh, dear.
Damn. yeah, it just, and all of a sudden I can just hear Lou saying, oh, face it, Dougie, you'll always be a jelly belly. And they had, like, they've got this little, like, fitness competition going on. And Doug's having a beer after he's finished working out. But then you look on the side behind him, he's actually had three or four. It's like, oh. Wow. Yeah.
And Lou would only usually save that for Harold in later years.
Wow. Okay. Oh, well, okay. Well, that's all I've got.
Right, okay.
But major events in the 80s and 90s, I actually couldn't remember anything. And then when I tried to do my research, it was all about things in the noughties and onwards. And I thought, well, that's a bit odd. I don't know if other people writing articles couldn't be bothered to
possibly
do much research or something.
So you don't remember the characters of Des and Daphne and Daphne dying in a car accident and her hospital scenes like that. That was like the first scene that I remember watching. That I think I remember seeing somebody actually die in the show. And it was like, it's quite a harrowing event because I remember that she sort of was laying in her hospital bed and Des was like, oh, you know, you can't leave, blah, blah, blah. And she sort of mumbled something and he thought she was coming back to life and she ended up like flatlining. And I just remember that was quite a cruel way to go.
See, that seems so familiar to me. I'm looking at pictures of Des and Daphne and they don't look familiar at all in the slightest. But yet you said Des and Daphne. I was like, oh, in the big wedding and everything. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I'm just looking at pictures of them now at the time. I don't recognize them whatsoever. So I remember it in one respect. But I can't quite for the life of me make any sort of emotional connection to them because I can't remember what they look like. Oh, and God. Even though looking at this picture, it's just not ringing any bells for me. So like I've got nothing there. So I can't, again, I guess I'm just not a big enough Neighbours fan. I'm sure there's like 30 and 40 somethings out there right now asking me like, what the fuck is wrong with me? But yeah, I just, I don't care in the nicest possible way, because wow. I've got no emotional connection to him whatsoever. Okay. Excited.
Wow.
What family were they part of?
So they weren't. I mean, they just lived on the. Des lived in that house that the Kennedys took over in right. the 90s. So they were just friends with the Ramseys and the Robinsons, or Des was anyway. I think in the I want to say the first ever episode, they're having a hens stag do for Des, who's supposed to marry someone else, and Daphne's like the stripper that Shane Ramsey hires to come and dance, and I think that's like her way into the soap. Yeah, I think that he's just someone who lives on the street at the time, who is just friends with the Ramseys and the Robinson guys.
Wow.
He was one of the 12 original characters, apparently.
God, that's bonkers. I just know the name, but I can't quite picture him. I can't hear his voice. I can't imagine him. I can't imagine his face moving. I've seen this picture now. I was like, no. That's so strange. I feel like I've missed out on something there. I feel like there's a... I don't know. I feel like Susan Kennedy after she slipped on milk and forgot the last 30 years or whatever.
Do you not remember the storyline of Harold disappearing?
No, I do remember that. Yes. Now, it's funny. I must have watched a hell of a load of episodes, because I actually remember the one where he disappears.
Yeah.
I remember that. And then, I thought he was gone like 2 years or something, 2-3 years. But it was actually 5 years, wasn't it?
Yes, indeed.
5 years!
91 to 96, I think.
That's insane.
Comes back as a Salvation Army guy called Ted. He's got amnesia and doesn't remember it. But then he ends up on Ramsey Street again, and it starts to slowly come back to him. But
that's crazy. I just remember watching both of those episodes.
Yeah.
Like they were really close together. And I just... I remember like the absolute... Like I think I was confused. I think I was confused about the disappearance act. Like that was never properly explained, was it? Which I think is fair enough, because if he's got amnesia, then he's not going to be able to tell Madge what happened to him. But I think the idea is that he slips and falls and he goes...
Drifted. Yeah, he was on like these cliff rocks, wasn't he? They were on the beach and he gets swept away or something. And the only thing that Madge finds is his glasses. So I'm assuming that, you know, the way they sold it is that he got swept out to sea, but survived and got washed up elsewhere. And obviously in Australia, another part of Australia. And... comes back a few years later. So,
yeah, and I don't. A lot of people get upset about the disappearance one in the way that they feel like it wasn't explained enough. But I think it needed an air of mystery. Unless you're going to kill someone off, that's got an air of finality about it. But if you do want to bring someone back, I think that's a good way to go about it. I quite liked this storyline. I thought it was. It was terrible because if we've ever met anyone like Harold Bishop, you would know that actually he's really irritating.
He is, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And you don't ever want to know anyone like Harold Bishop ever.
No.
But he was a very popular character. We all enjoyed having him in the show. So it was quite sad when that decision was made to have him disappear. And the show just didn't feel quite the same. Like, it went on. The show went on, obviously, and people still enjoyed it.
Yeah.
But then I think you need art needs to reflect life. I think I said this on the show last week. And without all aspects of society in there, and then sometimes it just doesn't feel quite right.
No.
And I think everyone knows. Everyone knows that you need a Harold Bishop in there because he was in there for so bloody long.
He was. And I mean, I remember seeing an episode today about Kerry Bishop, his daughter, who ends up in a relationship with Joe Mangle, who was a great character on the show anyway, Joe Mangle, who was, I want to say, was the son of one of the older ladies, Mrs. Mangle, which obviously is obvious because his surname's Joe Mangle.
Oh, yeah, Mrs. Mangle. I forget. Remember Joe? I just forgot about Mrs. Yeah, yeah. Oh, crikey.
Yes, and I just remember Harold just, like, being vehemently against Kerry, like, being with Joe Mangle, you know, getting into a relationship with him and him being, like, the stuffy, you're a bit of a hooligan and all that sort of stuff. I thought, you know, Harold, I think eventually through the years, he became a little bit more likable. But I think in the big early years, he was a bit more stuffy and up himself and all that sort of stuff. But do you remember the Kerry Bishop? Because obviously she married Joe, had, I think they had Sky. I think she had Sky Bishop, who wasn't Joe's daughter, but I think Joe ended up trying to adopt her or something like that. But I just remember Kerry getting killed in one of the episodes. I don't know if you remember that episode at all.
No, you know, yeah. Until you just mentioned her, I'd actually forgot she existed. But then as soon as you start telling me about that storyline, I'm like, he did, you're right. And it's just a lovely surprise. It's like, it's a really lovely surprise coming back to me. It's like, you know, you've watched the series once and then you go and watch it again. You know, oh, I forgot this. This is what this is like. You telling me all about it. I don't remember it, but it's, well, obviously do, but it's in the back of the cupboard, you know, with all the old shoes and, you know, the bags and stuff. You know, I have to go rooting around for it, and it's in there. It's great. I love it. Yeah. Oh, Joe Mangle was a cracking character, very different to his mum, if I remember.
Yeah, he was very different. His mum was very uptight and very stuffy type of character, and he was just more of a, you know, an easygoing guy who liked a good time, liked to have a beer or two, you know. He was a good, you know, good, I can't remember the guy who played him now, even though...
Mark Little.
That's it, yes.
He Big played Breakfast.
A great, yes. He played a great character, so... I remember the storyline between, is it Doug Willis, who one of the son of Terry, of Doug Willis's son, who ends up having, like, he ends up going out with Natalie Brulinger, who's on the show. And then Lauren Carpenter, who's Lou's daughter, shows up and they end up having, like, an affair or something like that. I remember that happening as well.
Oh, Annalise.
No.
Lou had an affair with Annalise.
Oh, did she? Did he?
Natalie and Brulia, it was Beth.
Yes.
Introduced Lou to Annalise, and she moved in as the lodger. But then he ended up having a relationship with her. It's when her mum turns up and says, "Oh, you know that my daughter's 17, don't you?"
No. I think I've forgotten that one, but
yeah.
I just remember the Brad Willis affair that he had with Lou's daughter, Lauren, while he was going out with Natalie and with Beth at the same time.
Can't imagine Brad doing that.
Yeah.
What, cool surfer dude Brad? I can't imagine. Yeah. No.
He did.
Wow, that seems weird. I can't imagine that.
I remember there's a scene where I think they get caught. They've been in the pool outside or they're doing something. And I remember they're both in towels on the sofa, like, together. And I can't remember who walks in on them, but obviously they get caught and found out at that point. I was just like, this is pretty racy for a 10-year-old or a 9-year-old for 5:30 in the afternoon. But this is the shit I remember.
Well, that's it.
Definitely happened.
Well, I'm the same way with Annalise and Lou. Yeah, I was thinking, I couldn't believe that this beautiful woman would have gone to go out with this old man. What are you doing? And then remember being absolutely horrified when I was thinking, like, wow, she's a kid.
Yes.
She's not that much older than me. Yeah, it's like, that's bonk. God, there's so much, isn't there? Like, we could literally be here forever. Can you imagine going back over old episodes now? Like, I tell you what, speaking
old
of confusing...
Old episodes and old characters, yeah.
Speaking of confusing, I just want to just move on to... Because I think that this deserves part of the show just to themselves. Okay. The Robinson family tree.
Right.
Now, honestly... I started reading that, and then I decided to put that down and read something less complicated, like, you know, quantum physics.
Okay.
Now, because that just irritated the shit out of me, trying to, like, because there's so many characters in that family tree that I didn't bloody remember.
Yeah.
And of course, there's characters who have had different actors.
Yeah.
Quite a few in Neighbours, actually. And then there's characters who disappeared for one reason or another before I started watching it. And I was just like, no, you know. And of course, everyone's got bloody different names as well, but they're still part of the same family. Oh, no, this is doing my head in now. Like, oh, my word. So you've got Helen Daniels.
Yes.
Straight away, as the family matriarch, if you like. Her husband, I think, is Bill, dead.
Right.
Okay, so she must have had a daughter that married Jim Robinson. So you've got the mother-in-law living with the son-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And then he's got four kids.
Yeah.
His wife has died, giving birth to number four. He then gets a girlfriend or an extra wife or something, and she's got kids.
Yeah.
And then she leaves or dies? I can't remember.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden he's got more kids.
Yeah.
But at the same time, the daughter, his stepdaughter, has got married.
Mm-hmm.
To someone else. So it's like, oh, you know what? I'm not doing this. Like I said, I went and I picked up some particle physics or something. I was just like, it's too complicated, man. I'm real. Like Debbie Martin.
Yeah. She's the daughter of Julie Robinson, who becomes Julie Martin.
No, sorry. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, Julie. I'm thinking of Julie Martin. Sorry. Because Julie was played by two different... It's Debbie and Hannah, the kids.
Yes. Yeah.
Julie's the mum. And Julie's actually played by two different women. So I was just like, oh, right, now I'll get on. And to make things even more complicated, so is Philip.
Yes.
Like, why are you doing this? Have you, like, what's wrong with you casting? Can you just make your bloody minds up? Do you want someone in this program or not? Like, yep, we auditioned them. We went all week. They were fantastic. They filmed a couple of episodes. Nah, don't like them. Get rid of them. Or, like, you know, or is it the actors? Do the actors go like, no, I've given it a go. I'm bored now. But I, for whatever reason, they used to chop and change your character so much that... Even a really a complicated family tree like the Robinson family tree then becomes almost impossible to follow. That was a nightmare. But like the Robinsons, you had Jason Donovan, yeah, that's Scott.
Yes,
that's right. Oh God, thank God I got that right. Okay, so and then of course, on top of that, you then add Kylie in there, don't you?
Yeah,
Charlene,
because she's got the Ramseys in there as well. I mean, I was going to say, you were talking about the Robinson family tree. There's the Ramsey family tree as well.
Oh, that's, yeah, no, by this point, I think the little boy that loved Neighbours so much has started crying.
I remember an episode being where the Robinsons and Ramseys were feuding for so long, and they have like a bet or some kind of competition as to see what the next. Because obviously it's called Ramsey Street, but I remember there's an episode where I think the Robinsons win like this competition or this bet with them to actually name the street Robinson Street or something. Obviously, it gets, you know, the Ramseys get it back. But I just thought, you know, that it's just a whole mix of just what is going on. Because I just remember the Scott, Charlene, situation being like they were the first two to marry each other from their families. So
the other thing that confuses me is like, what gives them? Like, how did they do? They have special power over the local council. It's like, we've decided, seeing as we've like they didn't have they weren't. It wasn't named after them, though, was it? Like, they didn't have any...
I think it was. I think it was to do with something, like, from a long time ago, but I'm trying to remember exactly what it was.
Oh, my God, I would have to know about that, because otherwise it's like, okay, I give up. Soap operas are bloody complicated. Like, you literally... Like, the only way, I think, to fully understand any soap opera is to literally turn up at the very beginning and then watch every single episode without fail.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the storyline gets so holy. It looks like a cheese grater. You know what I mean? There's like, that doesn't make sense. What's going on here? Like, so, when I watch EastEnders, like, I catch 5 minutes of Ellie watching EastEnders. Who's that? What's going on there? What's happened to that building? I don't understand. I get really frustrated.
Yes, I mean, I think I've just looked at it now as to what I've just put in. Why was it called Ramsey Street? And it basically said that it was named after Jack Ramsey, the grandfather of the original character Max Ramsey. So that's why it was called Ramsey Street. So the guy obviously was the first person there, and they just named the street after him. So,
well, bugger me.
The storyline was where the show was going to be, the street was going to be named Rams Bottom Street, but Harold Bishop led a protest against it and won. So it's like,
of course Harold did.
Yes,
if anyone was going to protest, of course it's bloody Harold. excuse me. Right, I'm trying to think who else. Like, there's famous families in there. Like the Carpenters, not the musical family. but you had like Lou and Cheryl. Although Cheryl wasn't.
She was Carpenter, a Stark.
She was a Stark.
But they did marry, didn't they? Because they had a daughter, didn't they?
Well, this is the thing, isn't it? This is what I was going to bring up. Do you remember that Cheryl was, as well as being played by two different women?
Yeah.
You know, for a short while. The main actress that played her was ill. And I'm just thinking, is ill code for rehab? I don't know. Like, I'm interested. But, you know, you'll never know. But, yeah, not only was she played by two different women, but the main actress actually disappeared for a little while, and it was because the character had been kidnapped.
Yeah.
I've never seen this story anywhere else. Like, and in even if there's something even remotely like this, they'll be there in on the action. Yes. No, not this time. They just flat out just got rid of her for a little while. You're gone.
Yeah.
Gone. And which is great in a way, because then you felt the absence of that character, and you felt Lou's pain, because he just, you know, he was a mess.
Yeah.
I thought that was really well done. I just never heard anything like that before. Like, wow, abducted. That only happens to people in films. You know, I thought that was fascinating. But then she comes back and she's pregnant, and she ended up having an affair with one of the other people that she was kidnapped with.
Okay.
I remember thinking, although probably not, I didn't use these words, but, you know, skewed, like, priorities there.
Yes.
Cheryl, like, it's like, oh, could die any day. Better get myself some dick. It's like, it's like, really? Like, of all the things you could, I would be there. I mean, okay. I'm not saying I've ever been there, but I just, wow. I was livid. I'm sure there are cases where that has happened.
Yeah.
You know, you end up making very strong bonds with people in a similar situation to yourself, and things I imagine do happen. But for a kid, I was livid. I was absolutely livid at Cheryl, and then I can't remember. I'm pretty sure Lou knew about this at the time, but then he decided to be Lolly's dad anyway.
Yeah.
But then after Cheryl's death, where she tries to save Lolly from being run over, she gets herself hit by a car.
Yeah.
Then Lolly's biological dad turns up and says, I want to be part of her life.
Yeah.
With his wife, who must be equally, who must be as pissed off as I am. Yeah. Like, what are you doing? What do you mean? What do you mean you want this child of the, you know, that you had when you had an affair with this woman? What do you mean? So anyway, and they take her away. Yeah. And like poor old Lou is just there, you know, widowed and babyless.
Yes.
And you know, I can't really remember how he got over that, but I was thinking like, this isn't realistic. This just is not realistic. Like, surely, because I don't remember the rest of Ramsey Street rallying round this poor man.
No.
I don't remember that at all. I remember a few, like, are you all right? Kind of thing. But, like, yes. I can just imagine if that was realistic. Like, the support, the amount of support for someone as affable and as cheeky and as likable as Lou. It'd just be that would be the whole show, I would imagine. Because, but I just remember thinking, like, does no one care? Like, if I was watching that now, I would think that the residents of Ramsey Street are all sociopaths or something. Does no one care? No one care that he's what, you know, that he's wifeless and childless now. Like, what is going on? Help this poor man. Like, it should have been some sort of decline into alcoholism or something there. Like, yeah, he lost the house or something, because that's a heck of a storyline. Yeah, it's absolutely mental. And I can't think of another one that was quite so bad as that.
No, I can agree with you on that. It was crazy.
Whatever Carl and Susan have got up to in the 3,000 years that they've been on the show.
That's true, actually, yeah. They've done a lot.
They've done a lot. And it's all in, like, the noughties, probably.
Yeah.
But even Carl was present in the...
They were there in 94, I want to say. He has, like, an affair with... is it Sarah? Sarah Beaumont,
no idea, can't remember that.
she was this young, attractive.
The secretary.
Yes.
Yes, I do kind of remember that.
Nicola Charles.
Ah, yeah, I do kind of remember that. I kind of remember Susan's response to it more than anything, if anything at all.
But I
remember just watching a very, very short clip. I'm thinking, shit, I watched this as well. I was there. I watched this. How did I forget about it until now? Yeah, Carl just like jogs across the road to go and talk to Cheryl shortly before Lolly decides to run out in the road. And it's like, God, bloody hell, Carl's been there for so much of it. It's like, hang on a second. If Carl was there and, you know, and he's and, like, there's a child running out into the middle of the road.
Mm-hmm.
And also, this is a fucking cul-de-sac. How fast could that car be going?
Yes.
And then also a woman running into the road after that child, and then she gets hit. It's like, dude, as a human being and as a doctor, you suck. You absolutely suck. He's there just thinking about, you know, the next gig he's going to be playing. He's just there thinking about the right prescription. He's not even thinking about what he can do to save Lolly or Cheryl. That's
no.
Man, you suck, Carl.
there has been quite a lot of interesting storylines in the 80s and 90s. And I mean, like you say, it's difficult to remember every single one of them. YouTube is a good source for showing old clips and even old episodes that were, you know, in their original BBC recorded straight from they're things you got Andy Peters introduced in the show at the end.
Oh, lovely.
So anyone who's interested should go on and watch some old episodes of Neighbours. But I mean, the only reason I asked if we could do a Neighbours episode, because obviously we all found out, well, obviously we all, I say we all, but most of us found out that Neighbours was going to be cancelled in June of this year. So I just thought it was a great way of looking back over a show that sort of, you know, took you away for 25 minutes of your life, you know, whatever was going on at school or in your real life, you could just get away and watch it. And it just, yeah, I mean, I haven't watched it recently and I haven't watched it since I moved back from France. So it's a shame. Because, I mean, again, it was a big part of my childhood. I mean, obviously, you don't remember most of it, but you remember some bits, but you don't remember most of it. But, yeah, it was a good part of my childhood, and it'd be a shame to see it go, but...
It will.
We live and learn, I guess.
Yeah, no, I mean, there's lots of things I remember. I just needed a little nudge to remember them. Like, there's something that I'll never forget, and I don't know why I thought it was so cool, but for whatever reason, the Pet Shop Boys were in an episode.
Right.
The Pet Shop Boys are driving themselves in like a convertible to their next gig.
Right.
And I think they ask Helen Daniels for some directions or something like that. Of course, Helen didn't know. I'm pretty sure it was Helen didn't know. No, it wasn't Helen. It was, Cheryl's mum. Short lady with grey curly hairs.
I know who you mean.
I think that was Cheryl's mum. I can't remember, though.
That was, let me just try and remember her name. Oh, God.
Oh, it doesn't matter. Anyway, and and then Annalise comes. Yeah, they drive off and Annalise comes walking down and they say, that was two musicians called, what was it? The Pet People. And Annalise absolutely loves them. So they just found the youngest, most attractive person they could possibly find on the show.
Yes.
And just went, oh, yes, I'm a massive Pet Shop Boys fan. It's like at that point, at that time, no one's a big Pet Shop Boys fan anymore. So,
except for my dad, but yeah, he loves the Pet Shop Boys.
I do kind of like them. They're at the very least, they're interesting.
Okay,
I quite like them.
They did some good music in the '80s and the early nineties.
They also did Absolutely Fabulous.
They did.
Yeah, that less said about that though.
Okay, excellent. Yeah.
But yeah, a few, and of course, one of the most famous residents of Ramsey Street had a whole episode about pretty much just himself.
Mm-hmm.
They deviated from the normal soap opera style and just went straight into a dream sequence.
Yes.
And you know what? And I don't remember a thing about him. This is Bounce as the Dog.
Yes. I don't remember much about that episode myself, but I remember it happening. So
yeah, I remember starting to watch it and thinking, I don't like this. I'm not a fan of musical episodes. I'm not a fan of dream sequence ones. I don't like things where animals talk. No, no. End of discussion. I'm here for some serious drama. And I just took myself. I remember just taking myself away from it. But yeah, that's gone down. That's gone down in history as being one of the most hated episodes by cast and fans alike. I can't even remember who owned Bouncer.
Oh,
was he just a communal dog? I can't remember.
Don't think he was.
I know.
No,
was he a Robinson's dog?
No, I seem to remember him being in the house where the Mangles lived. Let's have a look. Yeah. So Mike Young. Oh no!
Is that the guy that played him?
No.
So for anyone that's not aware. bouncer was a Labrador.
Yeah.
Golden Labrador. I'm not quite sure why everyone loved this bloody dog so much, but yeah, it, again, it's another one. It's this thing that's it's seeped into our consciousness. So a friend of ours ended up getting a Labrador puppy about like 97 or 98 or something. And for the entirety of that dog's life, one of my friends called him, instead of calling him by his name, just called him Bouncer. Yeah. I remember when we were in a queue, another friend of mine started arguing with the guy that was on the door. And I says, look, just don't worry about him. He's a bouncer. That's what he's meant to do. He goes, oh, I'm a doorman. Bouncer is a dog off of Neighbours.
So, yeah. So that Bouncer basically, I think, was Lucy Robinson's dog.
There we go.
And Mike Young, who's played by Guy Pearce, basically doesn't like him, but she goes on a trip to Europe or something and leaves Bouncer with him. And the Clarks, who I believe is Des Clark, so then Bouncer ends up moving in next door with Mrs. Mangle because she's lonely. And then obviously Joe Mangle shows up. So I think he stays with them for quite some time.
Bloody hell. You get this in shows, don't you?
Yeah.
This is very similar to Wellard.
Yeah.
In still a stupid name for a dog.
Yeah.
Wellard in EastEnders. I think that dog went through like, what, four owners or something?
Yeah.
Always like, oh, yeah, I'm really sorry, boy. I have to go away. And it's like, no one loves this dog.
No.
No one loves it. If you get a dog, it's a commitment until that dog is dead. But like in soaps, it's like, oh, I've got to go away. And you've got to stay here. So I'm going to give you to a family that I barely even speak to. And then like in like 2 years or 3 years down the line, they ended up with a character from which they've got no connection with the original owner. How like that poor, like I just can't imagine anything like that happening in real life. But yeah, I had this feeling that Bouncer, true to his name, did actually end up bouncing around quite a lot between owners. I thought he was a Robinson dog, but I knew he ended up somewhere else.
Yes.
But
well done.
Okay, thank you. You've mentioned Guy Pearce a couple of times. And this is a guy who, and I mentioned A-listers earlier on. And I count Guy Young in Guy Young. That's Mike Young and Guy Pearce. Oh, there we go. COVID made it there. I think Guy Pearce can single-handedly save any TV program or film. I think he's just one of the most talented, one of the most gifted actors ever. He's just ridiculously good. It the mind boggles. This is before everyone knew him as the amazing Guy Pearce, though. So what did Mike Young actually do? Because I don't remember him, Mike.
What did he do? God. That's thrown me in it. I know he was one of the not one of the original characters, but he was in there for quite some time.
He's a troubled teen or something, wasn't he? Like, did he live with some, with his family or another family?
Yeah. So he was. I was just trying to find out. He basically had been physically abused by his father. He moved in with Des and Daphne, made friends with Charlene and Scott, has a relationship with Jane Harris and becomes a teacher. So there we go. That's what he did.
Bloody hell. So like, you know, big, you know, it's a big change for a young actor to go through. I think it's funny that, you know, a guy that can do anything.
Yes.
Cut his teeth on a show with some seriously suspect scripts where they show him as victim, troubled teen, cool dude, reformed character, and school teacher. It all seems all over the place. But yeah, I wish I could remember him because, like I said, I love Guy Pearce. I think he's amazing. But he's not the only one. There's There's been quite a few. I don't want to go into all of them, but Russell Crowe, who, again, I think is he's underrated because I think he gets a lot of shit because he's there's a man that believes his own hype. But he is a seriously good actor. He played Kenny Larkin. Obviously, we've got Kylie Minogue, you know, the pop sensation that is Kylie. Natalie Imbruglia. A very forgettable character and really did absolutely fuck all behind the microphone apart from one tremendous song that will never ever stop being awesome.
Yeah.
I think that's really, I mean, no matter what, I know she was on Neighbours and I know she introduced Annalise. God bless her. And I know she's been a judge on some sort of talent program. I forget which one it is, but let's face it, the only thing she's ever done that you could say with any certainty that this girl's talented, I think, is Torn.
Yeah.
And it's not even her song. I'm pretty sure someone else did it before her. But still, massive. Craig McLaughlin. Do you remember Craig McLaughlin?
Do, of course I do, yeah.
Yeah, he was massive over here for a while. Like, is another Australian from Neighbours that all the ladies just like lost their shit over.
Yeah,
and then very quick
in Home and Away as well. Yeah.
Oh, did he? Oh, there you go. He had he also had a singing career, a brief singing career.
Oh yes.
Hey Mona. That's the only one I can remember. But he's there with his guitar and everything, and he's looking all tanned. He's got his tight jeans on in the video and everything. I thought this guy's going to be around for a while then.
Yeah.
And he literally just disappeared, didn't he?
From about 92, when he left Home and Away, he just disappeared off the international. I'm sure he did a lot of stuff in Australia and New Zealand.
Yeah.
But he just disappeared off international radar.
Yeah. Like he was in some sport, I want to say some sort of like spy program on BBC. Like it was
possible.
Quite serious. It was quite, it took it at least took itself quite seriously. But I remember, no one really, you didn't get any stick. It was a reasonably good program, but yeah, it just disappeared. But not saying that.
Is that what you mean? Bugs.
Was it?
The spy show, Bugs.
Oh, that'd be it then.
Yeah.
I was so busy. I like.
Oh, that'd be it. Yeah, he was in Bugs. Yeah, I remember watching Bugs actually for a little while.
Yeah, I think I must have done as well, but I can't really. I thought if I had heard the name, I would remember, but no, I know I watched it, but I was like, is that the name? Well, fair enough. Okay. Not good. So we've gone from one end of the scale to the other with Guy Pearce and Russell Crowe and Kylie Minogue, and then we've gone to the other side with Natalie Imbruglia and Craig McLaughlin. And then we want to go like somewhere in the middle. Of course, Jesse Spencer.
Yeah.
Jesse Spencer played Billy Kennedy.
Yeah.
Now, everyone remembers the Kennedys.
Yeah.
Obviously, been talking about them, but like obviously there's Libby and Billy.
Yeah.
The two most ridiculously good looking kids ever.
Well, and they had the other brother as well, Malcolm.
Yes. Malcolm
Kennedy, who was for a while as well.
Oh, I can barely bloody remember what he looks like. Hang on. Prepare to Google search. Malcolm Kennedy, Neighbours. Oh yeah, no, I don't remember him. I don't remember his face at all in the slightest. I do a little bit now. Yeah. God, that's weird. That's weird. Like, I know he was in there, but his face again, like Dez, is ringing no bells. That's weird. But that is weird. How do I not know his face? I've watched him over and over and over again. That is so strange. Wow. I kind of recognize his face in the credits.
Yeah.
Otherwise no. Loads of girls ran my way that I knew. Oh god, they loved Billy Kennedy. Oh my word.
Yes.
Oh my word. Like it was illegal. that kind of the things that those girls would do to him. It was unbelievable. I think because teenagers are idiots, I think seeing that, I went through a short phase of dressing.
I just remembered the gran from the story about the Pet Shop Boys. It was Marlene. Oh dear. Sorry about that.
That's all right. That's good. I'll complete again. There's another character I forgot all about. Oh my word, fantastic. But yeah, Jesse Spence, he hasn't done a huge amount since, but you know, quality over quantity. And let's face it, if you're in something like House,
yeah,
and you are a main character and you are, you know, you're respected and you're in there from beginning to end, then well, there you go. You've obviously got some skills. I thought he was fantastic. I thought he's a great character. So he's done, you know, he's done very, very well for himself in that respect. I really like him. He's one of those character actors. And this is, I think I like character actors more than stars, because you see them in something and you go, oh, I love this dude, or I love this woman. Like this is going to be a good episode.
Just because
you know they're going to deliver the goods. They're going to say or do something, and it's going to be absolutely magnificent. And one of the best ones for doing that, see how I work that in there. It's like I've been practicing or something. It's like we've been doing this for 3 seasons. one of the best character actors you can get, who flies so far under the radar, he's practically underwater.
Oh.
Is Alan Dale.
Mr. Jim Robinson.
Jim Robinson, right. Like, now, I remember Jim having a heart attack.
Yeah.
And dying again. I watched it. I couldn't believe that. That was terrible. Also, he was not that old. I want to say, like, early to mid-50s?
Something like that, yeah.
And I remember it shocking me.
Yes.
Like, you know, in my mind, he is old.
Yeah, quite a violent heart attack as well on the show.
Wasn't nice.
No.
But I remember thinking that he was old, but in my, you know, in my child's mind, you know, I'm like 10 years away.
You're
from
like,
it
oh
now.
My God, he's ancient. He's ancient.
But he's not that kind of old where he dies.
No.
You know, and I think even as a child, you know the difference between I'm going to die soon old and like just old. Fogey, and you know the difference, and Jim was not that, and I it shocked me. That storyline really did shock me as a child. I was like, I can't believe this is just what, and again, and I think in a weird way, kind of like having a very adult reaction to it. I remember thinking, what's going to happen to his family? What is family going to do?
Yes,
because he's very much he's very important. He was the glue,
for
that family, because that family was all over the fucking place.
Well, you still had Helen at the time, but because I think he wasn't at the time going out with some kind of con woman who was like after his money and that sort of thing.
I think that's Annalise's mum.
Yes, yeah. And she was trying to get his money and bump him off and that, but I think he died without being able to do anything to get her money over to her or something. But I remember that quite well. I remember when Helen died as well.
Well, that was off screen, wasn't it? Because
she died. I think they had like a family gathering with the Martins, and she was on the sofa, and they thought she was asleep.
Yeah.
And then Hannah was there going, oh, you know, she was acting like, oh, she's just asleep. But then, like, when I think Carl and Susan leave again, the bloody Kennedys are there.
they're harbingers of doom.
Yes. They're shunted out the door, and Hannah's like, Gran's not really asleep, is she? And they check on her, and yeah, she passed away peacefully on the couch.
I do remember that. Bloody hell. In that case, it couldn't have been that much after that they killed the character off that the actress herself passed away. I seem to think it couldn't have been more than like 2 years maximum. I remember also herself really not being that well. Old.
I think she. I don't think she was well.
No.
That's why she was written out of the show.
Oh,
she'd right. been originally in there for quite some time. So she was there till 97. She passed away in 99, so yeah, so a couple of years later. She was only 68 as well.
Yeah.
And I'm like, back in the, I don't remember, it's weird, isn't it? Because like, she kind of looked a little bit older than what she was.
Yes.
When she first starred in the show, she was in her 50s, but she looked a lot older than that. But yeah, that was a shame, really.
It was, because again, really great character, and I think her real life character kind of shone through. That's why she was able to play that character so well. She was a very, very well respected, well loved woman.
Yeah.
And she was also like a former children's TV presenter, and I think that really did come through in that maternal instinct that she had with all of the Robinson clan. Could turn round and be like, "You're being a tit," but in the Helen Daniels type way, but was very maternal, and it was really, really sad. In my mind, I think that's kind of like the death knell for that family as far as entertainment went for me. You take Jim and Helen out of that family, and it's just chaos, and there's too much soap going on and not enough drama. They did it in a nice way. They did do it in a nice way, but still, that's pretty brutal.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think we've been chatting for quite some time. I think we should wrap this up.
Yeah, this is what happens when you don't structure an episode and you just waffle.
That's fine. I mean, there is a lot to cover from like the 80s. I mean, I know you said like this morning, like we was only on for 15 years in the 80s and 90s, but you know, those 15 years gave us some memorable moments. So.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Right. Well, there's no.
Gaz this week because of what happened last week.
Yeah,
we're gonna have another go for Gaz. This one's gonna make air, so we're gonna. We know what happened on the last going for Gaz, but only you and I do because you actually won that going for Gaz.
Smashed it, I would say.
We're actually gonna put one on. Hopefully, that it actually records this time.
Yeah, thanks.
We're gonna put one on. Yeah, and see if you can actually win the super sexy prize.
Okay, right, well, hold on to your hat, people, or just go for a wee. Either way, hold on to your hat, pull your socks up, and at the end of the day and everything else, don't go anywhere, because we will see you in a few.
Back again.
And here we go!
Well, time for the Insanely Dangerous Retro Pod Show, boys.
Gaz. Welcome everyone to a new and hopefully one that makes air episode of Going for Gaz. Last week's attempt was so bad the producers made the recording disappear. But this week it will be better. This week we will get it recorded, and this week Gaz can win his super sexy prize. So let's welcome him. Say hello there, Gaz.
Hello there, Gaz. Happy to be here.
Excellent. Yeah, so we had an issue with last week's recording. Yeah. This week, I said to you, we'll count the last week's episode, as we know that you actually won it. No, the listeners won't believe us, but we aren't liars. We don't make stuff up. You did actually win it, but we just thought we'd smashed do a new it. Going for Gaz for this one and see if you can actually attain the prize this week. So let's, are you ready for these questions?
Well, I don't know. I'm about as ready for these questions as Beyonce squeezes for her jelly.
Well, I mean, a couple of these questions we covered in the show, so I think you'll be okay. I think you'll be all right. So question one, 1987, Scott and Charlene's wedding was watched by 19 million people in the UK. But which song did they walk down the aisle to? Was it Unchained Melody, How Deep Is Your Love, Suddenly, or Time After Time?
Oh, crikey, sorry. Do you want to, sorry, can you just, don't give me all the, don't give me the whole question, but just can you tell me the
was it Unchained Melody?
Options, yeah.
How Deep Is Your Love, Suddenly, or Time After Time?
Oh, that's, I think I saw this. Oh, I think I saw this somewhere. I don't actually remember it. Is it Suddenly, though?
You've gone with Suddenly. You could have gone with How Deep Is Your Love, but you went with Suddenly. It was Suddenly, yes.
Yeah.
See, no, Angry Anderson, yes.
Can't remember that at all, but I did read it. I did read it. Wow. See, this is, see, kids, this is what happens when you read.
Well done. Now, this one I feel we covered in the show, so you're going to get this one easily. All right. Question two. Jason Donovan's real-life dad, Terrence, was Neighbours character, major character. Who did he play? Was it Dan Ramsey, Carl Kennedy, Harold Bishop, or Doug Willis?
That would be Douglas Willis.
Yes, it was indeed, yes. Well done. Two for two so far. Three left.
Wow, this is amazing. This means so far, this is my great, this is like my best run for like forever. This is like seven questions correct.
So far, yeah. Well, you have won the Going for Gaz prize.
Before, I have, so. but let's be fair, my Going for Gaz run of late has been shit.
Yes. Excellent, that's very true. Okay, question three. The bar within Lassiter's complex has had various names throughout the years. What was its original name? Was it the Lassiter's Arms, the Waterhole, Lou's Place, or Shay's Shays?
Shay's Shays, isn't that from like Hollyoaks or something, Shay's Shays?
No. Or Shay's Shays is what they may have called it.
I swear that is in Hollyoaks as well, but
it could well be.
Ah, damn. Okay. I remember it being the Waterhole, but I think that was a change. This is gonna be a tricky one. Sorry, what are the
Lasters Complex, Lou's Place, or Shay Shays?
Yeah. Lou's Place. We'll go with Shay Shays. I don't know. I just because of the way you, the way I don't know. Yeah. No. Oh, this doesn't matter.
Gone with Shay Shays.
I don't know, because that's just a massive guess, and I don't. Yeah, no. It was just I don't actually know, but I'm just going by the tone of your voice. So yeah.
Going by the tone of my voice. Wow. You went with Shay Shays. That's incorrect. It was the Waterhole.
Oh, damn it. The Waterhole. That was my... I tried to get inside your head and I should have just gone with my original answer. Was that the original name, really, from the from day one?
As far as the answer told me, yes.
Ah, gutting. Huh. Oh, well. Deflated, mate.
Wow.
Deflated. Done. You know. I'm just going to sit on the sofa and eat my donuts now.
Not good. Let me just...
Let's have the next question then. Oh, I'll just try and mask my disappointment for the rest of the show.
No problem. I mean, it was renamed Shay Shares before being called Lou's Place.
Cheryl.
Yeah.
Cheryl. So, of course, it wouldn't have been Shay Bloody Shares. I knew that. Whatever.
No.
Stupid program.
Unlucky. Right, okay, question four. Hollywood star Guy Pearce started his career in Neighbours, and who did he play? Is it Shane, Ramsey, Brad Willis, Joel Samuels, or Mike Young?
That would be Mike Young.
That is correct. Michael. It was, yes. Yes, it was. Okay, so we won't drag it out much longer. In 1990, Kerry Mangle became the second character in the series to be killed off. She died in an unusual way. What was it? Was it fell off a cliff while flying a kite, shot while protesting at a duck hunt, or eaten at a zoo by a lion?
She was shot.
Well, protesting at a duck hunt it was, yeah. Wow. Unlucky. That damn waterhole question screwed you up.
No, I got inside my own head. Oh. I should have just gone with the bloody waterhole. Grr.
Never mind. Well, there's always the next two going for Gazes that we can maybe do something for you with next time. So, with great trepidation, we say goodbye to everyone, Gaz.
Goodbye to everyone, Gaz.
What happened way back then? When? Way back then. When's then? Then.
Hi there, pod fans. Thanks for joining us as we take another glance into the past and have a retrospective gander at what we were all talking about back in the day. So we can do this, I send Dangerous out to the garage and I have him wheel in our favourite item of record-rousing detail-detecting bit of kit. Here it is in all its glory, the Retro Monthinator 3000. Right, I don't know about you, but I'm hungry for some headlines. Dange, fire up that pooter.
Good evening. Here are your headlines from March 1990. The Duke and Duchess of York's second daughter, Princess Eugenia of York, is born. Dub Be Good To Me hits the UK number one. Born on the 4th of July hits the UK cinemas.
Cooey. Okay, well.
Yes. Easy for me to say. There was a few bits in there. I was like, oh, I'm moving on to the next line and I haven't even said the first line yet. Oh,
the last 2 weeks have really, they've just been, well, they're just
horrendous.
Well, yeah, we'll put it in the fuck it bucket and just try and forget about it. Right, where do we start? Okay. This.
It wasn't much going on in the 90s.
No.
March 1990.
No. I mean,
most of the headlines were very political. And obviously we try and stay away from the political side of things.
We do. Although I love your first one of these ever. The first ever one ended with Thatcher's still a bitch. the Duke and Duchess. Well, the less said about the nonce formerly known as Prince. the nonce who was formerly a prince, sorry, I should say. The better. Less said about him, better. Born on the 4th of July. It's one of those films that I'm like, I will get round to seeing that. Like, obviously, I'm very aware of the film and its importance within cinema and what it's about. And yeah, it's very, very good. And I've probably spent a lot of time watching crap films that don't deserve my time. When I could be watching things like this. But this has just always been on my to-do list for some reason. Yeah, it's taken me my whole life to watch this, almost. And I've still got no plans to watch it in the next week. Maybe I should. So I think we're just going to have to... I tell you what, I don't know a lot about Beats International, but I feel like there's something to talk about there, something to look into. Yeah. So... I'm going to say we'll talk about Don't Be Good to Me.
Okay. Yeah. Which we all know was written by Norman, our friend Norman Cook.
Yes. Yes. Norman and the show go well back.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. No, we don't. For anyone that's listening, we don't. but yeah, we love Norman because he has been not only in the House Martins. He was obviously in.
he is Fat Boy Slim.
Yeah, thank you. And Beats International. I forgot the name of the band. I was like, we literally just said it. I don't know what's wrong with us this week. This show really is going in the fucking bucket.
Yes.
Oh, man. Our brains are going, our brains and what little talent we have is going the same way as Neighbours.
You have talent, or we have talent. I don't have talent.
Together.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Between the two of us, we make up one talented person.
Right. Okay. I'd say half a talented person.
But, sure. But yeah. So Norman's awesome, yes. And he was also married to Zoe Ball. There you
are
go.
They still married?
No, I don't know actually. I don't think they are. I think she's a bit of a cow from what I have read over the years.
I never liked her anyway, so.
but yeah, so it's not just Norman. There's also Lindy Layton, the foxy Lindy Layton. very lovely. Yeah, got a little bit stuck on that. But yeah, also Lester Knoll and Super Andy Boucher. From Brighton. I didn't know that. I mean, I knew Norman was.
Yes, he's a Brighton fan, so.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Oh, sorry, I forgot about MC Waldski and David John Baptiste.
Oh.
Apologies there, everyone. Sorry about that, lads. They weren't around that long. It's like 80, 90, 92. Yeah, they're clearly talented. Okay. Yeah. And there was clearly something there. Now, they got to number one. They got this absolutely tremendous. I mean, if you listen to the lyrics, if you listen to the lyrics, they're kind of. I don't know. It's an everyday song. You know, the lyrics are, they're not remarkable. No. I wouldn't say, but it's the way that she sings. It's the way that she sings it. And of course, also the bit in the middle, which everyone, you know, the tank fly, bass walk, jam, nitty gritty. You listen to the bar from the big bad city. This is jam hot. Every kid wants to learn that. Every kid wants to learn that. And I didn't learn it until last week.
Yes.
Yeah. It's brilliant. And when you hear that, I don't know what it is in the background, whether it's a harmonica or something, it's haunting. with her, the way she sings, it sounds almost ghostly. So it goes along with that haunting, tune, and then you know, interspersed with little bits of electronica and rapping and everything. It's like, fuck, this is a ridiculously good song. Now, did they just spunk their load? Did they just spunk their load in this? You know, doing this because they weren't around very long.
No, I mean, I think they had this song. I think there's another song that I know of at the time, but I don't know what the, I don't know what happened to them, to be honest.
Yeah, because like, I mean, I think I might be doing them a bit of a disservice when I say that the lyrics aren't all that great. But like, yeah, it's a story as old as time. You know, there's a girl who's slightly insecure about this guy that she's crazy for. So it's something that, yeah, and he turns out that he's bad news. But you know what? She doesn't care. And it's not been done as much as say other sometimes, you know, than the typical boy band shit of like, I love you, I fucked up, I'm sorry, take me back. Mm. That's been done about 3 billion times. But yeah, this is slightly less. Yeah, this is slightly less common. But it's a good theme. It's a great theme for a song. But then I don't know how you would categorize this. If you listen to Whitney Houston, is it Saving All My Love for You? That's the one where she's like, she's having an affair with a married man.
Okay.
That's there's a sweet melody to that, and you could be, if you didn't listen carefully to the lyrics, now I think you could be fooled into thinking that it's you know, the situation that she finds herself in is a lot nicer.
Yeah.
Whereas the music that goes along with this could almost make you feel as though the situation is worse.
Mm-hmm.
Like I feel like this is very like this is I don't know, I feel like I said, it's almost ghostly.
Yeah.
And like, you know, yeah, it's, you know, like there's a haunting melody, and the way that she sings, she does almost sound otherworldly or ghostly herself. And it's just, it's always kind of, I've always associated this song with almost with death, like, you know, but danger.
Okay.
Like, you know, almost like a passing. And maybe that was intentional. Maybe it's like maybe this is her realizing that this is the end of her troubled relationship, you know. So there is a demise of sorts. It's the demise of the relationship. But it really doesn't seem like that. It's she just does not give a shit, unless it's the death of her self-respect.
Right.
Because she's always saying, people always talk about reputation. I don't care about your other girls. Just be good to me. Friends are always telling me that you're a user. I don't care what you do to them, just be good to me. Again, it's not Shakespeare, but it's making it incredibly, incredibly clear that she has just given up on, you know, on herself.
Yeah.
You know, as far as she's concerned, all she needs is this asshole. She does keep going back. She's, I'm very aware that you're, you know, nothing even close to perfect, and people are constantly telling me that I can do better. And she says, love is a game of chances, so I take my chance with you, and you I won't try to change. And so now that's the thing. Now that's quite a unique thing to say there, I think. She said that we talk about it and I'd rather have a piece of you than all of nothing. Now, I've got, like, you know, friends who would say, you know, they can't understand the psychology of a young lady that would find a guy, a good looking guy, that's going to treat her like shit.
Yeah.
A lot of guys, and you know, and some girls, well, can't understand why women love bad boys so much. And you know, I think that the common belief, whether this is right or not, I might have it completely wrong, But the common, you know, the most common explanation is because they think that they can change this person, that they can fix them, they can save them. You know, so it's like, you know, I've got this beautiful, exciting young man who's obviously deeply troubled. Otherwise, he wouldn't treat me the way he does. But I can change him. I can save him. And we can save each other. And it'll be beautiful and romantic. But what they're not seeing is that you're not saving anyone. People like that very, very rarely change. But in this instance, and I think that's quite a common theme, that the girl, you know, the girl in a relationship, and it's usually a girl in this kind of relationship, doesn't see that it's poisonous. Whereas Lindy here is more than aware.
Yeah,
she's like, I'm very aware. Everyone's telling me. I'm very, you know, self-aware of, you know, of my relationship and my surroundings and everything. But I'm still just 110% head over heels in love with you. And he's like, it borders into obsession. And right. it's like, you know, I've been singing these lyrics for years, and I just don't feel like I'm seeing, I don't think I've ever seen them like I have now. Like I never knew the bit by the tiny little rap type bit by David John Baptiste. I never knew that before.
No.
Yeah, you always kind of pretend you do when you're singing it on the radio. Yeah. You know, it's just nitty gritty.
Yeah. Yeah, you just mime it a bit.
Nitty gritty. Yeah.
This is damn hot. Yeah. That's it.
Of course, as a kid, it's like, is jam hot? Is jam hot?
Yeah, I suppose it can be. If you toast it, I guess, and you put it in an oven and a pie or
jam, hot jam. Ooh, that's got tongue scalding all over it, written all over it. But yeah, no, I think it's I think they may have spunked their load on that, because where do you go from there? Because I think you get a lot of bands, and we've seen them over the years. You know, we were young in a wonderful time where there was still amazing music.
Yes.
And we were spoilt, and I don't think we realized how, like, we would, like, you know, we would moan about boy bands, girl bands, or maybe the latest craze, or like this new type of music, and say, oh, it's not as good as this, or it's not as good as that. Actually, quite a lot of the stuff we thought was shit is infinitely better than the stuff that's out today. No, I don't, you know, and this is a little bit different from the stuff that I listen to usually.
Yeah,
I have to say, I don't know about yourself.
It was as well for me as well. Yeah, but I mean, you look back on it now and you're just like, you know, there was a lot of bands from the 80s and mostly the 90s and this kind of music where they, you only really remember that they only had one song in the charts that that was any good. But it's on one of the best of albums of the 90s, and you're like, this is a great song, I love this song. But you look at their other stuff and you're like, oh, they've not really done much else, have they? It's just like the 90s were full of bands who just kind of hit the big time. You know, I guess we call them one hit wonders, but I guess they weren't. You had bands that just didn't have as well known songs as that one sort of breakout song that they did have.
That's it. I mean, they kept on trying. It just, for whatever reason,
they never found it again.
That's it. Now, the trouble is with really, you know, with having your first song, that's an absolute belter. Like, it's a 10 out of 10. That's the trouble with having a 10 out of 10 song as your opening song that, you know, that introduces you to the world. You're better off having like a 7 or 8 out of 10. Yes. It's still big enough that people sing it.
Yeah.
But then you are able to grow. So, like, you know, I mean, I think The Killers are shit. Okay.
Right.
I think The Killers are shit, but that first album, wow. Holy fuck. I thought that is magic music. First album. I will never ever get bored of that album. And I just there are times when some of the songs on there can make the hair on my arms stand up on end. It's proper, and you feel things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then they fucked up with everything else afterwards. And this is a case. This is the greatest thing that they collectively, together as a group, that they could ever muster.
Yeah.
I just don't see how you top this song with that group of people.
No.
I just think it's bonkers. And I think because they weren't around for very long, and Norman was in the House Martins and then went on to Beats International.
The House Martins weren't around for long as well, to be honest. Because I think they were around for a few years, but then they ended up splitting up, and I think they ended up doing the guy went on and did the Beautiful South.
Yeah, of course, yeah. And I never did go and listen to Carry On Up the Charts.
No, so yeah, they were around in the 80s until about 88. They broke up. And Paul Heaton and Dave Hemingway formed the Beautiful South, while Norman Cook went on to become an electric dance music DJ, and then he founded the Beats International. He founded the group Pizza Man and Freak Power, and again those two, I've never heard of them before. He rebranded himself as Fat Boy Slim.
Yeah, wow. I tell you, he's a bugger then, isn't he? Because wherever it's like he turns up. It's like wherever he goes, he turns up, he fucks you up and goes, my work here is done. I mean, to be fair, he's a wonderfully, wonderfully gifted. I think he's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he's a totally undervalued musical influence. I think both him and Jarvis Cocker just seem to have just vanished off the radar. And if you ask younger people, it's like, do you know about artists from our time? Very few of them know who any of these people are. You know, I'll mention bands and like, I know Damon from Blur. It's like, oh, all right, okay, oh yeah, no, I know the Gallagher brothers from Oasis. But people like Norman Cook and Jarvis Cocker, even though Jarvis Cocker was in a Harry Potter film, they've just vanished, just like a fart in the wind. And it's like, it's bonkers. They've made some of the most interesting, well put together, thoughtful music.
Yeah,
the mind boggles. It's like when we were kids, we liked older music.
Yeah,
and we would go out and we would look at the music and the bands that came before we did.
Yeah.
And we would find the links with these musicians between all the different bands and et cetera, et cetera. People like this just doesn't seem to be important thing to do.
No, anymore. But a bit overshadowed by all these attractive looking people who can't sing but look good, so they just make them famous and make them singers these days, and all the songs are just like crap. They just end up becoming bloody TikTok music for a little while, and then you're just like, okay, that's enough of that. That's boring,
right? Yeah, instead of worrying about being the best,
yeah,
in their minds, getting the most hits, you know, on social media is being the best. It's like, and this is the problem I have. Like, no one's interested in being the best artist anymore.
No.
Or the smartest person in the room. All they're worried about is being the best looking, getting the most likes.
Yeah.
It's like, what happened to being the best? Why doesn't anyone want to be the best? And I know we're talking about Dub Be Good To Me. We're talking about Beats International, about a group that were like here one minute and gone the next, and we shouldn't really be putting them into a sentence about the best of all time or anything. But this is a shit hot A grade awesome number one song.
Yeah.
And I will never not love it. And I think a lot of other people feel the same way. So I can we not get a repeat of this? Like, even if you're gonna burn hot, burn bright, and burn yourself out, why don't you just give it everything you've got and be, you know, like some of these one hit wonders, and give something to the world other than another fucking TikTok page to follow, another Twitter feed to follow. Instead of worrying about that, if you haven't got a huge amount of imagination or talent or whatever it is you haven't got, just put everything you have into one fucking song. Just give yourself over to the world and show them what you can do, rather than just the shite that gets peddled today. It just makes me sad that I don't think we're ever gonna see.
Yeah.
You know, when, because there was a lot of groups, wasn't there? There was a lot of groups that would have like.
There was.
Oh crikey! What was that?
It's me saying, yeah, there was.
Oh, something just went. sorry.
That wasn't me.
Interference. Lovely. So it just makes me really sad that there's not going to be this abundance of one-hit wonders anymore. Because when they get this one-hit wonder, it's like, oh, let's milk these pricks. And then they'll release a couple more songs that are absolutely shit. It just makes me angry. It makes me angry that, you know, we've allowed quality to we've allowed the quality of our music to dip.
Disappear.
Yeah, to dip so far. It's like the Manchester United board who have just gone, right, we're the best team in the world. Right, where should we go from here? And it's become a money-making enterprise. You know, putting their name on everything and attaching their name to everything, so it just makes more money, and they're not interested in being the best anymore, because in their minds, being the best means making the most money and getting the most clicks. And it's heartbreaking. But anyway, I've got to I find myself talking like this all the time. People aren't going to listen if I keep talking like this.
Oh dear. Well.
Let's get on to something a bit more cheerful.
Shall we move on to another segment then, shall we, I think?
Yeah, go on, tell everyone what's up next.
Oh, it's dangerous.
Okay, no more retro journalistic joy for you lot this week. That's your lot. We'll be back real soon, right after the break.
As Dangerous Day. Dangerous Dave. Stuff about the old days. Guess he's got the questions, Dave's got the memories. Maybe not his pop culture trivia, yeah.
Yeah! Oh, hi there. I didn't hear you knock. Come on in and warm yourself up by the fireplace. Pour yourself a drink and settle back and listen to another delightful Ask Dangerous segment. You've got to hold and give, but do it at the right time. You can be slow or fast, but you must get to the line. They'll always hit you and hurt you. Defend and attack. There's only one way to beat them. Get round the back. Catch me if you can, because I'm the England man. And what you're looking at is the master plan. We ain't no hooligans, this ain't a football song. Three lions on my chest, you know we can't go wrong. That's right, people, we ain't no hooligans. We are slow and fast, but never at the right time. So let's smash into this week's picks that Gaz is in store for our never-ending 80s and 90s TV theme matchups. So what have you got for me this week, Gaz?
Oh, well... I'll start with my little intro that I do every single week.
Okay.
But these past few months, it's months, but it feels like longer.
We've delved years, centuries.
We've delved into the mind of Dangerous to determine the greatest 80s and 90s TV theme tune ever. I'll give Dangerous four matchups and he has to choose who is the superior tune and therefore will progress to the next round. Some big hitters have gone home already and it's only going to get more controversial and more upsetting for me. But this is us, Dangerous. He is mighty and his word is final. So, co-host of mine, you are ready, I'm assuming, for Ask Dangerous.
I am ready, yes. Let's go. Let's do this.
Okay. Matchup one. Star Trek Voyager.
Nope.
Versus Sharp.
Oh, Sharp.
Yeah. Ooh.
Okay. Excellent.
This is Sharp of Sean Bean fame.
Yes.
I don't know if it was. I don't know if it was televised around the world. I'm sure. It's a very English program.
It was, yes.
But it's got some real big. It's got some real big names on there. You've got. You know what? I can't remember the guy with the bloody eye patch and the wig and the false teeth and everything. That he's. He's another great character actor who's been in things like Only Fools and Horses or whatever. It'll come to me after the show when I'm just like sat here scratching my balls or something. But Liz Hurley.
Oh.
Is
Curly Whirly.
Yeah, Curly Whirly, Liz Hurley. Oh, I love that. And Pete Popplesweets as well.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Who was also in the great When Saturday Comes.
Yes, there you go. And Baz Luhrmann's Romeo and Juliet. It's only one of my favourite films of all time, and I've forgotten the Usual Suspects. There we go.
Oh.
So yeah, he did a variety of things, but he was in he was a little shit called Obadiah Hapgood.
Right.
And he used to talk to a picture of his mother inside his hat until they eventually realised it wasn't his mum. He just stole the picture off of someone else. He's just fucking balmy. But yeah, very, very good. Very, very good programme. And the tune.
Alexis Denisov was in the show for three episodes, apparently.
Was he?
Yeah, 97.
Well, bugger me. I'm going to have to go back and watch it now.
So, Sharp versus Star Trek Voyager. I mean, yeah. I do remember Star Trek Voyager coming on. I want to say the BBC did it like after Star Trek Next Generation.
I would have said they. So I've got a really itchy nose, Pat. Oh. Yes, my mustache was going up my nose and it stopped me from talking because I. Sorry, let me start that again. It was Next Generation, then Deep Space Nine, and then I think it moved over to
Voyager.
Voyager.
She was the first female captain, right?
Correct, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
All very. I look back now and I felt like they were quite far apart, but they're all quite close together.
Yes, yeah. Okay. Which is the better theme tune out of the two?
Okay.
I am going to have to put through Sharp.
Oh, lovely. Not that I don't like Voyager, but there's something about the there's just something about that song that they sing. It's the same bloke who sings it every single episode, and it's always like, yay, he's singing the song again. I do love that. It's just it's a lovely song. Right. Match up to Relic Hunter versus the X-Men cartoon.
Ooh. Now, I don't remember watching it, Relic Hunter. I remember the show, but I don't remember I actually watched it, or I don't actually remember the theme tune to the Relic Hunter show. X-Men, the cartoon, I enjoyed a lot. I remember watching it on BBC One.
On BBC, yes, which I'm now going to call it BBC. forever now. That was amazing.
On the BBC.
The Namely boys are going to get a real kick out of that for you if they hear you say it like that. The BBC.
So, I think, I mean, obviously, I know people at the time were a lot of men that were like big Tia Carrera fans.
Mm.
But for some reason, I just don't remember watching. I think it was like started in like 99 or something like that. So I knew of the show, but I just don't remember watching it. I don't remember seeing the credits for it. So I'm going to have to, based on the fact the X-Men cartoon theme is actually pretty good as well. So I'm going to have to
put
the X-Men through on that one.
Cool. Okay.
That was easy.
Matchup 3. MacGyver versus Going for Gold.
Oh, wow.
I don't even know why I'm asking, to be fair.
That's pretty tough, though, to be fair. I mean, MacGyver... Oh. MacGyver's... I mean, the original theme is obviously pretty similar to when they remade the show itself. Obviously, the original was slightly better. I don't know if they use the same theme tune or not. I don't think it was. I think MacGyver, the original theme tune was obviously a lot more 80s style, but that was a pretty decent theme tune. But Going for Gold is Going for Gold. It was produced by Hans Zimmer, for God's sake.
You do. I forgot that makes a big difference.
Well, you know, he wasn't like doing his movie scores at the time. He wrote this blooming BBC One game show theme tune, Going for Gas, Going for Gold, Going for Lloyd. Okay. Wow. Much as it pains me to do it, I think I am going to put Going for Gold through, but just begrudgingly, because, I mean, the MacGyver theme tune was pretty good.
Okay. You seem like you're starting to get to grips with it now. You're like, I think you're starting to find it a little bit easier. I'm going to be interested to see what happens when you get to the next round.
Yes, well, whenever that will be in the next 15 to 16 years, we'll get there eventually.
It's actually...
Oh.
After this... I believe. Yeah, it looks. And then we're on to round 2.
Oh. Very good.
Yeah, so, you know, the end is in sight.
Excellent. So shall we do the last matchup?
Yeah, okay. Matchup 4. Time Team.
Oh, wow.
I can't imagine. I almost don't want to describe what Time Team is to the rest of the world.
No.
Because it sounds so fucking boring. But I love history. So it was literally, you know how like you get the one day cricket?
Yeah.
And it's because it's so fast, it actually makes cricket, which I think is quite a dull game, quite exciting.
Mm.
So imagine that concept, but with archaeology.
Yeah, yes.
With a bunch of kooky characters, like the guy, like who's always in there, he's always there with his hat, always looking around for something. Phil, I think. And then there's the guy with like the glasses, and then he's always wearing like a rainbow coloured jumper. And this is
Tony
before
Tony Robinson, for God's sake, there.
Yeah, Baldrick from Blackadder presenting
it. Stay tuned.
Stay tuned. And he's getting really into it. And he would get so animated about, you know, finding like a Roman toilet or something. Yeah, you'd just be like, can you imagine just all around here? And they do all these little diagrams and so let's go and see Phil's. Oh, no, we can't find anything, Tony. We'll keep looking, though. Yeah, he's brilliant. I love that guy. Yeah, there's a whole host of people. And they'd obviously get like students in to do all this shit for free and everything. And yeah. show their parents that they've been on TV and archaeology is not a waste of time and stuff. it sounds shit, but I think at the time, because if it was on a Sunday and there's not a lot on Sunday.
No.
I think you were expected to go to church, play board games, and have roast dinner.
Yes.
And then play more board games or something, or sit around reading a book.
Yes.
But, you know, we didn't, you know, that's not what we wanted to do. So we ended up watching Time Team. Oh, I loved it. But yes, is that versus This Life? Now, do you remember This Life?
Oh, does ring a bell.
Yeah, if it was made nowadays, we'd be bitching about it. Basically, it's just a bunch of, you know, pretty young things enjoying their youth in society, you know, just out and about in the world. And like they're, I think most of them shared one big flat, and then you'd get, you know, characters here or there.
Oh, right. Yeah, I do remember that. Yes. It has Rick from The Walking Dead in it.
Did, yes. That's how we all met Mr. Andrew Lincoln.
Yes.
And, yeah, a selection of other, unfortunately less well-known actors.
Yes.
But, you know, it's a good little, you know, a lot of swearing, I think, yes. Just from one person. Mostly just one person just saying fuck like it's a comma. But no, it was actually quite good. It was I don't know, it was a bit of fun. I think it was very much of the time. It was, you know, again, you couldn't make that anymore, otherwise it'd probably be really bland and uninteresting.
Yes. Yeah.
But you know, it had a couple of Asian people. It's not like it was like super white or anything. You know, there was diversity in there. You know, professionals, you know, all different levels of society and different backgrounds. And it was something very much of the time.
Absolutely.
It would be really fucking boring and bland, you know, especially because it was quite musical as well. That, you know, that Britpop scene kind of thing. It was very strong throughout that program. It'd be a little bit different with Ed Sheeran in it.
Okay. I am going to put through Time Team.
Oh, I wasn't expecting that. Okay, well, there you go. I've asked.
Excellent matchups again there, Gaz. Excellent stuff indeed. Now, bugger off out of my house. If I could actually get it to stop. I'm pressing stop recording and it's not listening. It's still recording.
I want to see if I can do it from my end.
Literally does not.
Hey there, Gaz and Dange, it's Andrew and Brandon from Namely 90s, your brother horsemen in this retro apocalypse.
Today we have a little quiz for you, a memory game, if you will, that Gaz has brilliantly named Quotely 90s.
Each week we'll send you a quote and see if you can guess its origin from some piece of pop culture in the 90s.
Just remember, our worlds weren't as interconnected back then, since we lived across the pond and the internet still ran at 26 kilobits per second.
We'll also, for our own amusement, do multiple readings and either do poor imitations of the character/person who said it, or just poor imitations of whomever we feel like.
If you're lucky, you'll hear Andrew slip into his terribly offensive English accent.
Was that enough of a setup for you lads? Are you ready for Quotely 90s? Name the TV show and, if possible, the character who said this. I love you, you love me, we're a happy family.
I love you, you love me, we're a happy family.
I love you, you love me, we're a happy family.
I love you, you love me, we're a happy family.
I love you, you love me, we're a happy family.
I love you, you love me, we're a happy family. I'm not sure they have this over there, and you're definitely too old for this one.
I love you, you love me, we're a happy family.
Is sung by everyone's favorite big purple dinosaur, Barney, voiced originally by Bob West on the PBS children's classic, Barney and Friends.
Honestly, I couldn't remember the actual lyrics and had to look them up, as I remember going, let's hang Barney from a tree.
And if you're interested in hearing more about Barney and Friends, we discuss it further on next Monday's April 1992 episode of Namely 90s. Find it on your platform of choice at namely90s.com/listen.
Now back to the dinosaur stuffing insanely dangerous Gaz and Dange.
Wow.
I think I know
what it is.
I think I know what it's like. Are they trying to get one over on us by like making it so obvious? It's so overt, it's covert.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I think I know what it is, but what do you think it is?
Well, I think it's Barney.
Barney, the big pink dinosaur. Or purple dinosaur. Yes, I think it is as well. Barney, who would sing that to his young kids that were randomly around him all the time.
Yeah. Where's his kids' parents? Why have they left him with a fucking dinosaur? Two dinosaurs.
Yes.
And to be fair, I can't remember the little yellow one. I want to say something like Lucy or something.
I'll go with Lucy.
Why not? It's probably right, actually. Yes. Like, to be fair, I think, what was it? She was a stegosaurus or triceratops? No, triceratops. Okay. And I think they're herbivore. But leaving them with Barney, T-Rex.
Yes.
Oh, that's shoddy parenting. That is shoddy parenting. Yes. Leaving him with a paedophile T-Rex. Oh, that's double danger there, isn't it? Double danger.
That's almost as bad as leaving him with Gorwin the dragon. From the <Dragon's Eye>. Oh dear.
At least you could run away from Gorwin, because otherwise he would just, like, if he tried to run after you, his paper mache would just fall to pieces.
That's right. Yes.
Well, he can actually run after you.
Yes. Yes. Oh, I felt like one of them did a very good impression of Barney, like as his actual voice of doing it. So
that's what makes me think that they're trying to throw us. Like we're gonna find out that this is like, you know, a documentary or something.
Yeah. Real life Barney the dinosaur. Yeah. Shall we find out the answer then, shall we?
Go on then, yeah. La 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 la. Bring it up now.
La 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 la.
I'm not sure they have this over there, and you're definitely too old for this one.
I love you, you love me. We're a happy family.
Is sung by everyone's favorite big purple dinosaur, Barney, voiced originally by Bob West on the PBS children's classic, Barney and Friends.
Honestly, I couldn't remember the actual lyrics and had to look them up, as I remember going, let's hang Barney from a tree.
And if you're interested in hearing more about Barney and Friends, we discuss it further on next Monday's April 1992 episode of Namely 90s. Find it on your platform of choice at namely90s.com/listen.
Now back to the dinosaur stuffing insanely dangerous Gaz and Dange.
Well, we do like to stuff dinosaurs, don't we?
We do.
And they got it wrong. We certainly did get Barney and Friends over here. Yeah. And in 92, I was like 10, so, you know.
Yeah. What's all this old shit, Matt? Yes. What's all this fucking old? Yes. God, yes. You might have been a bit too backwards. You might have been there in your cave drawing on the, you know, drawing stick figures on your wall while we were watching colour television. Cool, you cheeky boys.
Oh, yeah. Dear. Well, doesn't mean we actually liked Barney and Friends, but we knew it. We I can't remember what it was on. I don't remember.
TV.
It. Was it? Oh God, what's the TV? What's the TV? I just remember someone drawing a picture of it and like waving a picture around in front of a box.
That's what we had when we were kids. That's called a cartoon.
Oh right, okay.
Yeah. Animation.
God.
Oh yeah, that's a load of pictures waving around in front of a box. no, yeah, Ellie still sings that song to producer Buddy.
Excellent.
And he sings back.
Oh, right.
He's either singing back or he's telling her to shut up. But either way,
not this fucking song again. He's saying, God,
shut up, woman! I'm trying to edit. we're very, very aware of Barney. I mean, yeah, we wouldn't have liked it, but I'm sure we all had a sibling or a cousin or a friend's younger sibling or something that would have been well into it. Yeah, I'm sure we would have heard that song. I love you. Yeah. I know. I'm pretty sure a cousin of mine was bonkers about it.
Oh, okay.
I remember adults getting really upset about it. Right. Like, at the time, probably people about the same age that we are now saying, oh, because this is pre Teletubbies, wasn't it?
I want to say yes.
I just realized now Teletubbies is on when we were adults. I remember that. But this is almost like, this is what set the tone.
They'd had Sesame Street, so you had Big Bird, so
People
our age would have been, people our age now would have been used to seeing like this massive giant yellow bird on Channel 4 screen as Sesame Street. But anyway,
but they would have interactions with fully grown adults and have proper conversations, teaching kids how to talk and solve problems. Whereas Barney's just like, hello, everyone, let's just hug. Like, oh, no. Oh, you spilled your milk. Let's hug. Oh, like, why? What are you doing? Cancel Barney. I think that's the problem. People our age were saying that, you know, it's not good for kids to just listen to that dopey prick talk all day because he doesn't actually help. Like, I mean, it probably made the world a much happier place.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Turn around and saying, you know, no matter who you are, whatever the color of your skin or your background or whatever, you know, we can all be friends and hug each other and everything will be okay. Like, that's a lovely message to spread, I think it wasn't quite as helpful as Sesame Street.
No.
Which was actually going, hey kids, yeah, here you go, we're going to teach you to read.
Yeah.
Right. Hey kids, we're going to teach you to read and count and we're going to do it in a fun way. Barney's just like, fuck reading, let's just hug everyone. You see, that person doesn't look anything like you, give them a cuddle. It's not a terrible message, but I think it all started going downhill with Barney.
Yes.
And I've got it on good authority that Mark Zuckerberg actually got the idea for Facebook from Barney the dinosaur. Okay. So Barney is actually the reason. He's the reason for the downfall of our civilization. I heard he even had a tiny little clawed hand in the production of the first ever series of Big Brother.
Oh, as well. I can imagine he did.
Yeah, so this guy really fucked the world up. I hope he's happy with himself. I bet he's there sat on his pile of money going, I love Ed Sheeran.
Yes. Is this, Mark Zuckerberg? Yeah. I think he just left social media on MySpace. You know, everyone, all the only thing people had to worry about on MySpace was who was in your top 8 or your top 12 friends.
Yeah. Oh. Simple times, eh? Simple times. Yeah. No thanks to you, Barney.
Yes.
Oh, right, but thank you very much. Well, we're getting a little bit away from the fact that this is actually Quotely 90s, and this is the I Hate Barney show. So thank you very much for you, Namely Boys. That's another smasher. Even if you forgot that we're only a little bit older than you. It's still wonderful. Thank you very much. And if you like your retro with a bit more modern 90s retro flavor, then make sure that you go and find the Namely 90s Boys on their podcast of choosing, on your podcast of choosing, even. Get out there. On their platform, on your platform of choosing. There are all good platforms and even some bad ones. So, yes, go do that because, they'll waffle less than us. And, they can string a couple of sentences together without going, there's a bat. stuff like that. And they don't have a crazy producer interrupting every now and again, disagreeing with me. So swings and right depends on what you want from a show. Yes. If you want professionalism and thought out critique, go listen to them. Yes, but that's it. I think it's that time.
It is.
Wow. We're finishing. I tell you what.
Show is done.
Yeah, although it's sad that we've stopped doing a couple of segments because it's lovely. It's a lot of fun. I have to say I'm a lot less worn out now.
Yes, I can imagine.
I just couldn't do pod pickers this week. So I'm sorry. I'm very, very sorry to everyone who's missed out. But I've got so much decorating to do. And I didn't sleep particularly well. And producer buddy was on at me at like 5 o'clock this morning going, I'm hungry. Yeah. Your mother is downstairs. Ask her. You're the one who does the food, Flatty. Come on, up you get. it's just doing my head in. I love him. This is a new thing. It's like, mum's up, you're up. No. You can wait for the fucking alarm. Nah. Mum's not letting me in. Come on, Fatty. I was gonna go somewhere else with this. That's right. Yeah, pod pickers. I just couldn't bring myself to do it. My brain hurts. And then I was trying to talk about Neighbours. I was like, do I do Neighbours? Do I do pod pickers? Oh, I don't know. What's that? My fingernails. More paint. Oh my god, where's all this paint coming from? So yeah, I just sorry. So every now and again, we're going to like just skip segments and everything. But, they will always come back. Even if they don't, they come back next week or they come back for a special or something. They're never gone permanently. So please come back. And, this is it. I'm never, ever going to ask you to email into the show ever again. Done. Not interested. Don't do it, in fact. I'm just not going to ask anymore because I don't know what it brings to the show. Nothing, in fact, I think. But what I will say is if anyone out there wouldn't mind giving us a follow or even a review, it would be absolutely wonderful. We've got so many lovely reviews. Everyone's been so kind about the show. There are some friends in there who have listened and been very nice. There are some critics who've not friends of the show. They've just been very, very polite and, not just like, this is an average show. No, but they've actually said, it's a great show. They've been so very lovely. So we appreciate that. But we also want you, the listeners, to, if possible, please try and give us a review. You know, give us five stars, give us four stars. We're not that picky, but yeah, please give us a review, give us a like, give us a follow, pass it on to one of your friends. Just do something today to make our lives a little bit easier. Make us think, you know what, we want to come back next week and we're going to do this because we've got, I don't know, one more new review. We've got, we've got more listeners this week than we did last week. So go on, go out there, do something lovely, something that will put a smile on our faces.
Absolutely.
All right. Because we want to get rich off of you. The plan is eventually to, you know, change it up to a YouTube channel and make a fuck ton of money, like some of these 10-year-old kids playing with toys. You are now, like, you know, raking in 100 grand a month or something. That's the plan.
100 grand a day, yeah.
Yeah, and then I can retire, and you know, I'll hire someone to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and produce a buddy. That's the plan. That's why I need you.
Tremendous.
Right, I'm gonna go, not because I'm tired, I'm actually wired. It's this new I say wired. I've woken up compared to my rude awakening earlier. A little furry alarm clock, yeah. But I don't know about you. You want to get an early night?
Yeah, I've got a meeting in the morning with the Australian company Red Grundy, who originated Neighbours, to do like a TIDRP TV channel that funds Neighbours and keeps it going. But, only with the old cast. Like, the old cast has to come back with a few new, fresh faces in there as well. So, yeah, I'm going to try and set that
That's
up.
Good.
Save
I like
the
that.
Show. Save the show.
Say no, insanely dangerous retro pod show with just a few more listeners. They could retire before 50.
Oh. Very good.
Very I liked good. It. Awesome. Right. Okay, dude. Well, yeah, I'm not. I've realised what I've been doing. We've been saying, "Oh boy, we love it." Yeah, that's all for now. We realise that the actual bit at the end of the show says that for me, so I'm not going to say that anymore.
Okay, Insane X and Danger Heads, that's us all done for another week. Time for Danger myself to leave you in our rearview mirror like a real life outrun. Don't forget to contact the show for a chance to win some goodies and make sure you tune in next week for more retro radness. Until then, you stay frosty.